Interesting. Is there a window that's one of these items that makes people jump out them or something?
Maybe.
Or look through them? Or touch them? Because they seem to imply that you had to cover your eyes as swiftly as possible.
pardon my minor distraction. But thank you, Josh, for the second raid today. How you doing? Welcome. I was quarantine treating you. I guess I asked a couple days ago, but still, I will repeat. How goes control? It is so good. I don't know if you've tried this one yet, but it is worth a look-see if you ever get the chance.
Yeah, we're playing one of the DLCs, so...
Yep, this is the expansion.
Expands upon the story.
Yeah. Not a whole lot of, like, immediate spoilers, which is nice. So, like, if you haven't seen this before, it's not so bad, but... Oh, right, I was getting rid of pretty much anything that is... Apparently there are T6 mods. Let's see. Damage against enemy armor, don't care. Rate of fire, don't care. Projectile speed, don't care. Headshot damage, that's okay. Ammo cost per shot, eh.
It does make me wonder, though, if... Rate of fire, eh. If a game like this doesn't necessarily change much graphically, or with its... programming or engine from one game to the next, is it possible for them to release an expansion as a DLC that you pay for as opposed to
I've talked about that before. I'm super in favor of developers doing that, but the market as a whole is not. Most people never play DLC. Like, just habitually, they
don't. But if you say, hey, you know, we're coming out with the second chapter of Control, you know, pay for it, download it, add it to your base game, play them seamlessly back to back. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Why couldn't it be a chapter system?
I think that could work. I know that's what Valve wanted to do. And so I think it could work specifically in this game's case because the Epic Game Store is just bankrolling them. Let's see, energy recovery and melee skills. Nah. Get rid of all of these.
Because in a way, it's like how MMOs have expansions.
Yeah. And I think if you could actually train people to get used to it, I think it could actually work incredibly well and save a
lot
of time and money.
Device?
It's just breaking.
Mm-hmm.
It's just bad collision.
Mm-hmm. They look like old school computers.
That they do. They're still there, though. Dang, those are tough. All right. Might as well heal up. Hey, ability points. I actually have a bunch. But yeah,
Oh yeah, modern ones don't work in the house. Yeah, that's right. They couldn't have anything that hooks up to the internet. Because they were worried about something being able to communicate with the outside. That's also why they had to have no cell phones, just the landlines.
Yeah. I forgot about that. But yeah, I think if you could really, like, build the culture around it, and I think that's actually... That is a discussion that we as... those of us that, like, get really into games, I don't know, just...
Which one do you choose?
The right one!
Oh, you're given two blocks here.
Yeah. Excuse me, you're mine! They cannot dodge me. Okay, let's see. But, like, I think this is a very valid conversation that we could have in terms of... I'm going to say cost reduction in game development. One of the main reasons why AAA is kind of turned heavily towards cheap DLC is because funding full productions is very expensive, and a lot of studios just can't do it anymore. Mm-hmm. And the ones that do are few and far between.
I was wondering what would have happened if you had gone the opposite direction and
put
that in there.
I have to go this way first, and then I believe we get a cube to go back. I could be wrong.
It could be one of those things where branches.
Maybe.
You're both surrounding yourself in rubble.
Come here, you. You're mine! You launch rockets with charge and then use force throw on them. I don't think so, unfortunately.
So you have two cubes here. Are you sure you don't want to take the other one back before going forward with the other one?
Yeah.
Also, that needs to be destroyed.
Mainly because I just feel like that's going to be more backtracking. I didn't like that. Okay, that's what's up. Oh, there it is. There we go. Now, I bet we have to go to both. Because there's two pillars here.
True.
And that would just involve more backtracking.
I just found it suspect that central area only had one block.
Yeah.
Unless going from one pillar to the next is the aim all along, but...
Possibly, probably. I wouldn't worry about it one way or another. Not yet. Considering we also haven't found any lore on this island, even if it turns out they are mutually exclusive, worst we're gonna miss out on is a fight. Which, like, it's okay. Yeah, gaming market's being saturated with current and old games. New games have a lot to compete with, even the potential install base is growing. True. I guess for me it's just like, it feels like we've kind of hit a bit of a singularity on a lot of graphics. Like, obviously, this game will look better if they made Control 3 20 years from now. It will look better, but it's kind of one of those where it's like, I don't really feel like there's a need to rush it.
I don't necessarily feel there's a need to make things graphically
better,
superior to this.
And so
yeah.
If they were to just use the same engine, the same everything, and just say, like...
But keep making new stories and experiences.
Yeah, and you know what? If that even involves Control 2 effectively being a standalone, both full game but also DLC... Ow! Like, I guess I could work with that. Conversely, there have been a lot of people complaining about this, I think with Resident Evil 3 specifically, that it used a lot of the same assets, and a lot of people are kind of cranky about that. That it's too much of a flip.
I want to be super comfy and, like, lay back in here, but I can't.
I mean, why don't we get your new headset for tomorrow? Let's see.
I suppose we can try it. I mean, otherwise I just get the weight.
So you kind of disagree. Stop playing WoW because the graphics haven't improved. There is a limit. I would say...
No, I love WoW. They've really improved a lot of the later animations and textures.
But I would 100% say that while they've improved it, it is still very much constrained by what it used to be. And I,
at the same time, it does allow your friends with computers that can't handle rigorous games to be able to play along with you.
Ish. Eh, I don't know. I would say you could get away with effectively having one iteration of your game spread across multiple, like, one iteration of your core game, if that makes sense. So, like, Control per console generation. So you would have this version of Control probably would last midway into the PS5, Xbox, whatever. I don't even know what the new one's called. I know they called it Scarlet for a while, but I don't think that's what it's called anymore. But, you know, just kind of have it last for like 5-6 years, and then you move on and overhaul all the graphics, come up with all the new assets, really beef up the technology, and then, you know, just kind of have these, not unlike the console generations, you have generations of your game instead of having just like having to reinvent the wheel every single time. Because I think that's, I've been watching a lot of retrospectives on why game studios fail, and a lot of them are because they have to like reinvent their own game for modern audiences, and it either takes too long, costs too much, or they like they have to like start over a couple of times, like what they did with Anthem. And yeah, so I honestly wouldn't mind playing just Control 2.
If you think about it, weren't some of the most successful games from BioWare using the same exact animation and like story engine?
No.
I'm talking like Jade Empire, Knights of the Old Republic.
Okay.
A lot of those.
Yeah, you're right. They were all using the same engine for a while. But that's an engine. Ish? Kinda? I don't know. Green.
I don't know if you can see this because I don't know if I'm really here. I see a pen in my hand. I see myself, but it's all wrong. It's the wrong angle and the wrong me, and it's all green. Look out for the color green. Everything turns green when it's close. Don't let it get close. Don't let it in. But if you do, no matter what, you do not speak to it. Please, I need you, Peggy. You save Peggy. I don't want you to end up here, too. I don't know where I've gone. What makes everyone green?
At the same time, I guess one of the flip sides is, like, one of the biggest complaints people have against Bethesda.
Yeah?
Is they've been stuck with the same Havoc engine forever. And, like, the rough edges are starting to show to...
Oh, like, do you mean for Fallout?
Yeah, for Fallout and Skyrim and whatnot. Like, Fallout 76 made in the same engine as... Was it Oblivion?
Oh, okay, yeah. No, that I can see. But then again, I think it's just because I never liked the aesthetic of Skyrim and Morrowind and all of their games. The characters just didn't feel right.
That's because they very rarely were characters. There are very few protagonists in any Bethesda game. Or
also,
protagonists.
The colors were always so
supporting
bleak.
Characters. Yeah, they were also very ugly. I think Fallout 4 is the only Bethesda game where I actually felt like a mild connection to another person. And even then, most of it was resentment. Gambrio engine. Yeah, there we go. Oh, you're still alive.
Hey, there's a box over there.
What, that one?
Yeah.
Already got it.
Oh, you already opened it?
Or, no, I didn't.
No, you haven't opened
it. I must have
it.
Gotten attacked and got distracted. Wait, you're still playing Control? Is this the same save file and new save? This is a DLC, actually. And that feeds into my point about how most people kind of just, like, blank on DLC. The marketing isn't there, and I think the audience attention isn't there yet.
But when a new expansion comes out for an MMO, everyone's like, oh, yeah!
Because a new expansion
MMO.
Is effectively a new game,
Ooh.
But cheaper.
Well, this is... I don't know how long it took us to play... Wait. Is that another recording down there? Down there. Yeah, look at the corner. But Yeah, to the left.
That, yeah.
Yeah.
Entry day plus 86. There's been a change. Hercules and Mabel. I mean, it numbers 3 and 11 attacked my staff today. 2 fatalities. 3 if you count Mabel. She was always so kind. As a result, we are abandoning the foundation. Northmore gave the order to transfer our resources to the upper floors. Now that my control points allow us to safely come and go from the New York streets, did I forget to include that fact in my previous logs? I've been so busy using the arrays I made. Control points have been established throughout the oldest house. Excuse me if I don't sound excited, it's just... A few months ago, I would have been overjoyed to leave the Foundation. But now I realize I've grown fond of it. There's something deep in the stone here, deeper than that watching presence. Something warm. I feel it needing me. I won't go. I'll refuse. Northmore won't be happy, but so be it. I'm starting to see him for what he is. An impotent storm. Father Shade in a cheap suit.
But what were we going back to? Also, there's something floating up there.
It's the TV.
The TV! Wait, what's on the TV? Oh, those creepy dolls. Oh.
If I'm gonna close out of that, there we go.
Oh, just see it and hold.
Let's see if we can actually understand. Nope. At least we can see it better. This feels like an SCP game, 100%.
So what are they doing? Are they trying to access it, probe it, touch it, and then The influence! It's melting his brain! Unless he was taken amongst all the floating... beings.
Rejected episode.
We have a lot of things that are flashing. We've seen them though, right?
Oh.
Oh, that was the mirror realm.
I'm trying to see if there's...
You and your special powers, the astral plane, rejected episode.
Yeah, so we've seen a lot of these. Except the music, we can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we've seen all of these. We've listened to all of these.
Okay. But what I was saying before was...
You're talking about MMO DLC.
Well, right, but what I'm getting at is I don't recall how long it took us to play Control, but this hasn't been an insubstantial DLC. It has its own story, it has its own zones, it has its own plot. It's an extension of the original game. and it's adding to the lore of the house and the it feels like more than just adding a couple new enemies into the world, like in most DLCs.
I definitely prefer this DLC to like what Resident Evil 2 had, which is just kind of like these weird bonus side stories that don't really matter. Like, I was looking at a lot of them, and they seemed more like challenge missions than anything interesting. If I want to play a DLC that is...
And this also doesn't feel like it was something that they could have included in the game but forgot to, or were holding on to specifically to milk people for DLC money. Because I know that... Aren't there some games that are released and
do have where, like, the whole DLC is in the game at launch, but it's just not unlocked yet?
Mm-hmm.
And it's very clear, like, story is missing as a result. Did we do the music machine tokens? We actually did not do the expeditions. It was something I wanted to do, but it came out at a really awkward time for us last year, so we didn't get around to it. Was it last year or was it a couple months ago? I don't know. Time is... I've lost all sense of time.
Time goes by far too swiftly.
It's felt like... March went by both really fast and really slowly, and a lot of that has to do with the lack of sheer, absolute lack of, you know, ability to go anywhere or do anything, which really throws me off really hard. But, like, from my perspective, I like DLC when it adds something to the story. One of my favorite DLCs of all time. I miss expansion packs, because one of my favorite games of all time is Red Alert 2, and the DLC Yuri's Revenge is amazing. Like, it's absolutely just, like, take everything you like about the base game, add a new faction.
They're swept.
Yeah, they dodge, so you can't just... There you go. I dodge, so you can't just, Wait, melee. Except for I'm no good at melee. So I'm just gonna run around shooting. There we go. But yeah, Yuri's Revenge is just, like, such a ridiculously amazing game. It's so campy, it's so well made. It's definitely a little janky compared to, like, the base game. Like, it definitely felt a little... like, some of the factions were a little overpowered, but, like, it didn't matter to me in the slightest. I loved every minute of it. But it was a direct continuation of Red Alert 2. Like, a sequel-ish. But, like, a mini-sequel, kind of still within the same timeline and recent events. So it's not just kind of like 20 years later, it's, like, almost immediately after. It's so good!
Anything interesting around these sides?
Not really.
Oh, that's a spike that you need to destroy.
I think I actually got around needing to do that. I don't really know. And so, like, for this really is not a DLC. This is a micro expansion. And honestly, I would love it if games went back to that and just said, like, yeah, here's a game, and then we're going to produce, like, five different expansions for it. Instead, like, I bring up God of War, the most recent one that came out. What was that, 2018? That game, if they had just doubled and then tripled the size of it without, you know, without having it be a separate game, I would have been pretty okay with that. Because, like, it didn't feel like the game needed... It didn't outlast its welcome. Conversely, there's games like Persona 5, which recently just came out with their own kind of standalone...
Oh, but they require you replay the entire game, right?
Yeah. Honestly, I'm a little bit less jazzed about Persona Royal because, like, you have to replay through the entire 100-hour thing just to get access to the new content. And it's like, I've heard they've made it so much better and so much more streamlined, but it's like... That's like reading the entirety of Game of Thrones for the director's cut version. because G.R.R. Martin decided to redo some things.
It'd be like if he added random sentences in your chapters.
Or like, and you had just to chapters to make things flow better, but you're not really ever told where they are. Mm-hmm. You just know that they exist.
So then you have to reread the books.
Oh. Whoops. So you have to reread all the books to figure out, like, yeah, what happened? I actually have that problem with Lord of the Rings, because I really want to see the extended versions of Lord of the Rings at some point. But I'm not really passionate about...
At this point, though, I know that Fellowship of the Ring was one of the movies that I love to watch over again and again.
Yeah, and I probably gladly would at this point, but there's a certain...
Because it's been about 10 years since we've probably seen it.
Yeah, right? But, like, I know it would take... hours and hours, and most of the plot would be kind of the same. And I kind of wish theaters would just show the extended versions. And it's just like, okay, extra $2, get comfy, watch the extended version. I'd be pretty cool with that.
I think then the problem is there'd be a difference in, like, ratings and such.
Oh, that's another one. Dragon Quest XI got a lot of new stuff for the Switch version. Extra voice acting, cutscenes, flashbacks, and some other stuff.
Uh-huh.
But only on the Switch version, not the PC or the PS4 version. And I'm still salty about that, because, like... So, I played through the inferior version. And I didn't want to buy, you know, a full $60 Switch version just to have the little bit extra... Nor would I want to, like, replay through it. You know, if it was a New Game Plus situation where it's like, yeah, you get to transfer all of your stuff, your characters are broken powerful, and you can skip past a lot of the boring bits. Like, I'd be cool with that. I could work with that.
Reminds me of how there was this kid who was kind of stalking my roommate and I on our floor freshman year. Like, just sort of inviting himself into our room. And stuff when we were just working at our computers and whatnot. Just to kind of creep and try to start conversations with us. And I remember somehow the topic of Okami came up. And I was really happy because I had finished Okami on the Wii. And I had played through it in its entirety and I found all the beads and such. And he was just so insistent that the PlayStation 2 one was superior because of the credits. And I admit, there's like this cute little animation thing for the credits and like an extra song and such, I suppose. But it's one of those things where I said to myself, I told him, I just said, you know, I don't have a PlayStation 2, I had a Wii, and that's how I was able to play Okami. But, you know, if you say that these credits are good, then I'll find, you know, a version on YouTube that someone has filmed. And he goes, no, you have to play through the PlayStation 2 version and, like, see it for yourself. And I just couldn't get it through his skull that I had the Wii version. I wasn't going to be able to get my hands on a PlayStation 2. I wasn't going to play through the entire game again on the PlayStation 2.
Some people are very strange purists about that. Oh, gosh, what game was it? There was definitely a game I played a while back that was both on PC... and consoles, and there were slight differences in, like, how it controlled. Oh! It was Diablo! It was freaking Diablo 3 when we played through Diablo 3 on the Switch, and I was talking kind of glowingly about the dodge roll system and the new targeting system, and a bunch of people got, like, actually righteously mad at me for daring to like the inferior Switch version.
Mm-hmm.
And it threw me off a little bit how vehement the reaction was.
Our recent confrontation, yelling, was an error. We determined you may have both tools upgrades. Only because you are the favorite current director. But do not listen, speak to former. You are welcome, grateful. Oh hey, look, they're there.
Yeah, I don't remember if they were there last time. Maybe I just never looked up.
We are nearly whole fixed. Your trust, synergy, they sure is appreciated.
Changed their tune all of a sudden.
Because they have to use her to enact their will in the physical world.
Overthinking this whole board former thing. They can sort out their own business so long as it doesn't get in my way. Obsessing over these problems is something Trench would do. But I've got my intuition. And you.
Question, is there another yellow cube around?
Yeah, there are. Yeah, right over there.
Over there?
Left, left, left. Forward, forward.
Where?
I think it's to the left, isn't it?
Oh, there's the boxes.
Okay, go to the right. I thought I saw one. What's over there?
Wait, oh. In here? Aha!
Oh wait, where's the opening? Yeah, there it is. Oh, kitty! Did you say hello to it?
Yep. And it popped out of existence. I don't know if I'm supposed to do any more with that or about that. But that's one of the eight cats. It's done, just mark it down. Gotcha.
So was this the way that parted?
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like it did kind of loop all the way around.
Well, we cleared the area, so we're now we're just warping back to the crossroads. let's see. Wow, they're just doling out the ability points. Let's see. Shield strength. I guess I'll just work on the shield. Okay, so we want to go... Wow, we're almost done, actually.
Well, we have new areas that we need to access with your crystal crushing powers.
Yeah, kind of.
But did you get all four of the keys?
Mm-mm. We got one more.
One more.
So we want to go back the way we came and hook a right.
We've got this area covered, Director.
What other interesting things? Like, I'm gonna stand by the whole potentially leveraging DLC as like a really cool thing that the games industry could actually do to save themselves money and still put out more stuff faster.
Mm-hmm.
What other things could there be? I don't necessarily know if I can get up there yet.
Well, as I said, it'd be great for things in BioWare games. And they even did have that for Mass Effect, didn't they? But it was unfortunately those, like, after-party things, but things that you had to do before the end as opposed to the aftermath. Remember?
Oh, jeez.
Whoa, you just got clobbered.
I didn't even notice that guy there. Let's see. Oh, are we talking about the BioWare DLCs?
Mm-hmm.
For like Mass Effect 2 and 3?
Yeah, but it felt like it was awful. It was adding stories that came before the end, and they were short and didn't really do much.
There are two reasons why the BioWare DLCs were garbage.
Mm-hmm.
Because
they could have been the thing where they added a new zone and a new subplot.
If they had been smart, they would have just baked it into the game eventually. Just bundled it. But what happened was BioWare got greedy, and probably by that extension, it was probably EA. But what they did was they sold the DLC with BioWare points.
What, BioWare points?
Yep. And so to get all of the DLC for Mass Effect 2 and 3, you had to buy BioWare points, which never went on sale, and therefore the DLC never went on sale. So if you wanted to buy the entirety of Mass Effect 3, it was going to be like $100-something or more. Like, it was a lot of money for something that most people saw as a frivolity bonus and something that probably should have been part of the game. It still is. And I'm going the wrong way. And it's yep. It's depressing because, like, I would gladly play the heck out of more Mass Effect 3, or I would have bought all of the DLC if it had been packaged at a reasonable price and in a manner that was accessible, but, like, it's not even particularly purchasable on Origin, I don't think. Like, I don't... Maybe there's a Mass Effect 3 complete, but, like, I've never seen it, nor do I really feel like it after what they did
Mass
to
Mass Effect 3 was just a lackluster ending.
It was...
We felt bad regardless of which ending.
It was very decidedly okay. No, it ain't here. Is this it? Oh, it's a big bathroom.
What? Brian's movie den?
Welcome to another episode of Brian's Movie Den with me, the ever-lovable Brian Hinnerman. Today I want to talk about a new film I found at Movie Night. That's Night with a K, the mecca for VHS aficionados in the greater Dallas area.
Yeehaw!
The movie is called Delivery Disaster.
Uh-oh.
Weapon in media res.
Okay.
A mailman.
I gotta stop. I can't.
No. Delivery Disaster is one of the evil tapes. I need to know.
Sort of Brian's movie
Fine.
Day with me,
I'll
the ever-lovable Brian Hinnerman.
I can't. The sound effects.
Well, I liked
Today
it more
about a new film I found
in the
movie.
Recording mode, not in the like in-game mode, because then you're going to get a lot of echo.
Brian's movie den.
Cringe time.
Welcome to another episode of Brian's Movie Den with me, the ever-lovable Brian Hinnerman. Today I want to talk about a new film I found at Movie Night. That's Night with a K, the mecca for VHS aficionados in the greater Dallas area.
I love VHSs. I miss them.
The movie is called Delivery Disaster. We open in media res. A mailman drives a truck full of packages down in an endless American neighborhood as a pack of rabid dogs chase behind. Now, these dogs are nothing like my stepmom's corgi Chuck. These were some real nightmare hellhounds. The dogs keep pace with the mail truck, tearing chunks out of the driver's legs and arms.
What? Ew!
The package he throws out the door is marked by his bloody handprint. He screams in pain and confusion, and this goes on until the movie just abruptly ends. There aren't even any credits, which is a pretty bold choice. Is this film a commentary on how our 9-to-5 jobs are killing us, or how hostile the modern world is to outdated concepts like mailmen? Perhaps
no.
It's merely a statement about the futility of purpose and how no task can ever be really done. There are lots of ways to interpret it, but for now, let's get to the part you're all waiting for. It's score time!
Score.
I give this film a 4 out of 5, only because the actor frequently broke the fourth wall by looking into the camera and shouting at it, like he was shouting at the audience. A little too on the nose for me, but I did enjoy it, and I recommend you check out other films produced by Blessed Pictures. Bike Hard and Coffee Bullet are the only others I found, But this little art house studio certainly knows how to push the boundaries of Western cinema. And a friendly reminder that there will be no new episode next week, as I will be visiting my aunt in Delaware for Thanksgiving. Thanks for listening, all you Brian fans, and remember, we all love movie magic, but don't forget about the you magic. Until next time,
Movie Den.
Brian's Movie Den.
Movie Den.
Brian.
This is Brian. This guy's a proto YouTube reviewer.
He is.
For movies.
So Chelle.
Yeah?
No. How do you feel about Chelle's That's Movie Den? Chelle's Movie Den. Movie Den. Movie Den.
Did you hear what the premise of that story was?
Nope.
So, do what I'm thinking? I'm thinking that this blessed movie pictures, somehow the camera pops up somewhere and videotapes someone and it kills them. Like, the movie camera kills them. So what happened in the delivery truck movie, the delivery disaster, was it was about a man who was trying to deliver packages. He was a mailman, of course. And these hounds, not corgis, as according to the speaker, Brian, but they're not corgis, more like hellhounds. And the hellhounds were tearing out parts of his arms and legs as he was trying to drive this truck away. And he was trying to interpret it as, oh, you know, people are performing tasks in futility, or maybe it's about how mailmen are antiquated and such, and, you know, their work is obsolete. I just couldn't help but think that whoever owns those dogs needs to, you know, keep up to date with leash laws and, you know, a fence, prevent them from attacking the mailmen. It's never the mailman's fault. They're the ones doing their jobs. It's the people with the rabid animals that need to be held responsible for instances in which they're attacked. I mean, come on!